Bridges have changed a lot in the past 100 years. Bridges constructed in the 1900s were usually bulky, used a lot of steel, and had low service capacity with a few lanes of traffic, and didn't span long distances. The average length of a bridge main span back in 1905 was around 150 meters. Today, you can construct bridges with main spans up to 2,000 meters. While bridge engineering have witnessed a lot of technical advancement, it is really the failures of the previous century that got us to this level. And all of that is thanks to the modern box girder bridge. We went from bulky designs of steel truss bridges to sleek and aesthetically pleasing cable stay bridges. Major arterial bridges take full advantage of this design, and all this because of the knowledge from decades of bridge buildings and failures. Wanna learn the secrets of why some bridges are hollow today? Well, stick around as we unveil the secrets of the box girder bridge. Bridges are structures built to provide passage over obstacles and deal with dynamic loads such as moving cars, wind and earthquakes. There are three primary components of every bridge. First is the bridge substructure, which are the piers, abutments, and the foundations that transfer the loads from the superstructure to the ground. Second is the superstructure that carries the traffic load. Finally, the bearings located between the superstructure and the substructure that reduces stresses and forces transferred between those two components. Girders are the structural elements of the superstructure, which help carry the traffic loads. The length of the bridge span varies based on the bridge design. Early in bridge design, engineers realized that girders achieve higher stiffness by placing more materials away from their central axis. The longer the bridge span is, the more bending moments and buckling the bridge has to resist. This is why bridge girders have long depths, because they need to resist bending moments from the dynamic loads imposed by cars and self-weight of the bridge. And we can prove this mathematically. This is the formula for beam deflection, where F is the force on the beam, L is the length of the beam, E is the modulus of elasticity, which is a mechanical property that describes the stiffness or rigidity of a material, and finally I, the moment of inertia, which is a measure of how resistant an object to changes to its rotational motion. When a force is subjected on the beam, where the width is twice the depth, the beam deflects by 1/8. However, if we change the orientation of the beam, where the depth is twice the width, the deflection becomes 4 times less compared to the first situation. This is similar to bending a ruler, which is easier to bend in a certain way when it is flat, but it is hard to bend on its side. While we could hypothetically use solid rectangular sections when designing girders, this would use a lot of raw materials and would increase the weight and cost significantly. Engineers realized that you could maintain higher stiffness and reduce buckling by only using materials where required. We can utilize the same equation for the moment of inertia for the general rectangular case. However, we subtract the hollow inner area of the rectangle, but you still achieve higher flexural strength. This means lower cost by only using materials where it is required, as materials close to the central axis contribute very little to the bridge stiffness. In addition, placing things away from the centroid also require the placing of stiffening sections to reduce buckling and distortion. This is why we have I-beams, which have upper and lower flanges for added stiffness to the beam. This feature can also be seen in steel sections and train tracks. If we modify the design a little bit to accommodate for a wider deck to carry more traffic lanes, you get box girder bridges. The box section may be either rectangle or trapezoidal, narrower at the bottom flange level than at the top. Box girders achieve much higher stiffness compared to I-beams because it joins two webs together with a common flange, which behaves much more efficiently. However, this didn't catch on very quickly. Early adaptation of box girders was not successful, as engineers didn't quite understand this relationship, which has led to a lot of failures. Modern bridges have utilized the shape of the box girders, which predominantly are made from reinforced concrete segments. Due to their high performance, optimized strength-to-weight ratio, low cost, and aesthetically a pleasing look, this reduces the dead load of the box girders by only using materials where required, which has significantly reduced bridge construction cost and reduced the amount of steel and reinforcements used in the girder. Modern construction methods also take advantage of this design, such as balanced cantilever bridges, where precast segments are manufactured off-site and lifted by using joint gantries. These can be grouped together using post-tension cables, which achieve high resistance against bending moments, buckling, and rotations. Then those tendons are stressed to achieve strong box girder span. Post-tension cables are run across box girders in a way that achieves higher resistance to bending moments. Box girders are also used in state cable and suspension bridges, where those segments are suspended by cables that transfer the loads from the cables to the pylon and all the way to the foundation. Box girders are also easy to maintain because they are designed to accommodate pre-stressing cables inside the girder. The span can also be used to run services such as gas pipes, water, and electricity. Because the area is enclosed, it provides a non-corrosive atmosphere and are very economical when it comes to achieving curves, which is harder to achieve using I-beams or Super T girders, and excellent for long and major bridges due to the cost savings. In addition to being lightweight, hollow box girders are also resistant to wind and other environmental factors that can cause stress on the structure. This is because the internal void in the box girders create a space for air to circulate, which help to dissipate the forces caused by wind and other external forces, and also reduce traffic vibration, which improves structural stability. Box girder bridges have a minimum design life of 100 to 150 years, which is way more than truss bridges, which usually have a design life of 100 years. Single box girders may carry decks up to 30 meters and even up to 50 meters for major roads, which can be very cost effective. Advancement in engineering and construction techniques continue to push the boundaries of bridge design, resulting in the construction of longer and more impressive main spans over time. While I-girder bridges can go anywhere from 20 to 50 meters, box girder bridges can reach up to 100 meters. While steel truss bridges can go from 75 to 440 meters, cable stay bridges with box girders can reach up to 1000 meters. Box girder bridges are commonly used for medium to long spans. The choice of bridge type depends on several factors, including site condition, budget, traffic volume, and aesthetic conditions. But nonetheless, box girder bridges are an impressive piece of engineering. And now you know why. Thanks for watching. Like if you love bridges and subscribe if you like this type of content. And I will see you in the next video. Cheers!